There's a 7 o'clock site plan amendment to Memorial Park Plan, Orlando Drive, Northampton, map ID 31C-44. Is there a is there a presentation?
So I know many of you. I'm Sarah LaValle. Among other things, I am the staff to the Northampton Historical Commission and also the Northampton State Hospital Memorial Committee. So we're seeking an amendment to a plan that was approved back in 2015. I know some of you were here, but since some of you weren't, I'll go back and give a very quick overview of the whole project. So the State Hospital was a big part of Northampton's history. It opened in 1858. It employed and served thousands of people. It closed in 1993, after which most of the buildings were demolished, and it is now Village Hill. And as part of the agreement with Mass Development, the city was charged with building a memorial park to memorialize the staff and the patients at the hospital. So location and context, there it is in Village Hill in the big map. It's on the east side of Orlando Drive, surrounded by conservation land to the east and house lots to the north and south. And it's also adjacent to the existing trail system. It's about a quarter acre in size. It's an interesting shape, but what's really cool about it is it's the original site of the 1876 fountain, and the base for that still remains on the site, which we will utilize as part of the park. So existing conditions with topography and plants, these photos were taken before the site was cleared as part of adjacent residential development. A third of the property is pretty much level, and two-thirds of the property goes down a steep slope to the east, down to the conservation property. It had been primarily overgrown and was partially cleared, some junky sort of species, mostly invasives and poison ivy, but the large trees still remain there. So an overview of the park as the full design was approved back in 2015. The landscape was to include a four-foot concrete pathway that went around the top of the slope that led visitors into and out of the park from Orlando Drive and also down to the conservation property to the east. The fountain basin will be exposed, lots of new tree plantings, benches, and interpretive signs. And this bottom shot is a picture of a fountain that's very similar to the one that used to exist at the State Hospital property in England. Our original plan was to restore everything that we have currently, which is the bottom yellow circled piece, and also recreate the pieces on top. It was found that it was really cost prohibitive to do that, so at this point we're just restoring the bottom. And at this point, electricity and water are not part of this phase of the fountain restoration. Again, that was really cost prohibitive, unfortunately. So this amendment request, we are seeking to allow us to get to work this spring. Otherwise, we'll have to wait. We won't be able to take control of the park parcel until we have funding for the full approved plan. We have about $36,000 on hand right now, which will allow us to get to work on some of the more basic elements. This is very quirky. So it's basically just a phase one. We're not changing the overall plan. So the original plan included partial screening of adjacent residences, interpretive signage, benches, turf lawn surrounding the fountain, and a daffodil project along the eastern slope that would memorialize all of the patients. Utilities, water, again, will only be supplied to the park via tap and Orlando Drive. The fountain is not going to be operational at this point. Electrical will be drawn from the nearest service. The park will not be lit. There's no lighting proposed. And utilities details, as DPW requested in their review of the project, will be reviewed and approved by them prior to construction. So again, this is just a scaled down phase one to allow us to get to work at this point, and there are no other changes to the original design. That's still our plan going forward. So what we'd like to do now is a stone dust path that connects the street, the park, and the open space, install the restored fountain on the base that's exposed, fine grade the slope and seed the entire park, and protect the existing trees on the north side. And just a little bit of background on some other things that the Historical Commission and and interested people are doing. There's a walking tour of Hospital Hill that will be accompanied by signage in the future. And this is a flyer that we distributed to some of the neighbors. So that's it. If anybody has any questions about what we're doing and why.
So we're not asking for approval for any changes. We're just asking for to approve the phrasing of what we've already approved.
Yes, that's correct.
So why is that necessary?
They're not changing anything. If they're just taking baby steps, why do we have to?
That's as far as we can interpret. That's Mass Development's requirement. They want to know that there's a buildable portion before they'll release, that they have approval, that the city has approval, or the historical commission or this committee has approval for a park before they'll release the land.
But didn't we give them that approval in 2015?
We did, but they don't have the ability to raise money yet for the entire thing, and Mass Development won't release the land to the city so that we could do fundraising until it's just like a chicken and an egg thing. So Mass Development wants to see that there's approval for something.
Right.
So you give approval for this. It's our understanding that that's enough for them to say, okay, you have approval to build just this piece, and then they can release it, and then fundraising can start.
I think it's just that they did not propose phasing, and so we just didn't have a way to draw the line for a piece that could make it deliverable.
Right.
Any other questions?
One other.
Yes, sir?
Just so water and electric is not included in this phase.
It is. Yes.
It is.
So we're going to... We'll work with DPW to do those connections now.
Oh, that's what I was going to ask. I thought that wasn't included.
We'll at least do the connection at the street.
That's what I was going to say. If you could do the rough now.
Yeah, but so at this point, we don't actually have any water or electricity proposed.
Sarah, so I recall when it came before the board the first time, there was a question. Actually, I raised a question about the kind of water in the fountain or how it was going to be serviced, and they said they weren't sure whether it would go down the drain or be recirculating, and that seemed very troubling. I just want to be 110% clear, we're not approving any water to the fountain.
Not at this point, no. Eventually, someday, we would love to have a working fountain and the entire thing restored. At that point, we probably will look into recirculating so we're not utilizing city water constantly.
Yeah. Yeah.
But at this point, the fountain restoration that we're pursuing is not going to be functional.
Well, the permit that was granted said that if water is to be utilized, it has to be on a recirculating pump. So
we did put that in.
Yes. So it's not that they have to come back to you to put water in. I mean, I think you should be clear in this amendment that it's for phasing and that all those conditions still apply. But that was put in as one of those conditions.
Okay, I think Carolyn's led us to the language for a proposal.
Motion to approve phasing of State Hospital and Memorial Park on Olander Drive, including all existing conditions on prior permits.
Second? Yep. And seconded? All in favor?
Yep.
Thank you.
Thanks, sir.
Second item on the agenda tonight is actually not open till 7:20.
We can do the other
item. I'm sorry, we'll have to wait till then to start, so we'll take care of some business. We have an A&R on Grove Street that divides a vacant parcel into two lots. Do you want me to show it?
Sure. This is at the end of Grove, and it's right where the right before the bike path. Let's see. So Evergreen is here, Grove, and then at the end is where the bike path connects in Leeds. It's this parcel here that is fairly large. No.
Just like it.
Yeah. Same surveyor. Yeah. So this, it's an urban residential lay zoning, so the minimum lot size is 5,000 square feet and 50 feet of frontage. This has 51 feet here, and it widens out up here. And then this would remain the larger portion. The property owner, there's nothing on it now. The person who bought the property is intending to build a home here and then sell this piece off for another residential structure.
And did you say the bike path is on the back?
That way, and then it loops around.
No, where it loops there at the end of Grove.
So it's actually not part of the rail trail. This is the private, sort of the connector through Beaverbrook Estates. Oh, okay. So it's that trail that goes, well, if you're on the rail trail, it goes up and around and loops to Grove Avenue.
Okay. Yeah. Any questions of Carolyn about doing an A&R?
So there is a house here now.
No, there's no
the
whole,
okay.
Yeah.
All right.
And it's kind of steep slope and wooded. Okay. So you might not even
realize. I don't think I realized that
there's,
was there.
There's houses all
right, yeah,
there across
right.
The street.
Okay. And there's like one on the corner and one, at least one more, I think, coming.
Yeah, this
yeah,
way.
Yeah.
I think this is vacant, if I recall correctly. Yeah. Why did they do that little jog instead of just doing a rectangle? It might have to do with the driveway
slopes. Or, oh, okay.
And yes, there's some slopes on there, so I think I'm not 100% yeah. certain, but there are topographic issues with the site. I think they're trying to meander a driveway up.
Motion to approve or to recommend approval of A&R plan for Grove Avenue.
Second
by Ann. All in favor?
You all can be the voting block that you the proposal for the night. It makes them easier.
Next on the agenda, we could do the minutes.
So move approval.
Get a vote in it.
Don't you have an
all in favor of approving both sets of minutes?
I think we
need to update yeah. the March 9th.
So noted.
You raise it.
Hi, Yuri.
What, with the date?
No, Dan wasn't here for that meeting.
Oh, you are? Okay. Mm-hmm. It's funny because I remember looking at that and I thought I took your name off. I'll fix it.
And next on the agenda, Carolyn would like to confirm the meeting schedule for summer.
So I can't remember if we talked about this. Ann and I had she jogged my memory to my thinking that we needed to schedule something. Then I think we never came back and did it. So July and August, typically, we just have one meeting instead of Thursdays in those months. So we should figure out now which meeting will have most representation. I think actually I just wanted to check. I think the July meeting, one of the dates may be complicated for me, but I just want to check. Oh no.
Anyone have anything they really want us to work around in July or August?
I can't make the first.
So it's July, the normal, so it would be July 13th and July 27th, and then the August dates would be August 10th and August 24th.
Yeah, I can't make August 10th, I know that.
I can't make July 13th.
Okay, so those are both the first meeting. So if we go with the fourth.
Second.
I can't make July 27th.
Yeah, actually, earlier for both would be better for me. I'm off. I'm on vacation the end of July and just kids going back to school end of August.
Okay. So maybe we should do a head count for July 10th.
13th.
You can make that. Oh, I went to August.
Oh, no.
July 13th.
No. July 13th. You're looking for yeses?
Yeses
on July 13th.
On July 13th. Yep. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven.
Mm-mm.
Okay, but John. Okay. And then, so let's say August 10th. Who can go come to that one?
I probably will.
Oh. One, two, three, four, five, six, 7? Okay, so maybe we should, and then do you want me to do the, for the fourth Thursdays too?
Yeah.
Okay, so July 27th then. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, that's slimmer. Okay, I'm thinking it's going to be the second meeting. And then August 24th?
Oh, okay.
I think we had more than five for both of the, so let's then, I would suggest the July 13th and August 10th will be the meetings for the summer. So let me just make a note of that. I can send it out in email tomorrow.
Yep.
Okay. That would be helpful.
Anyone have any announcements from their collateral assignments like CPC or TPC is busy looking at the chapter that has to do with transportation that goes into the revision to the sustainability plan. So we heard a presentation on that this week.
We gave so much money out the first go around for a number of large parcels of property, some of which we had dealt with here, that there's a relatively small amount of money available for the second round.
Yeah, and we bonded the park, right? So that's
yeah, that's right. Mm-hmm.
3 or 4 more minutes.
What's the story doing? I said, tell us a story, Devin.
Carolyn didn't expect us to be this far ahead.
Carolyn, you expect 2 meetings in June, is that correct?
As far as I know, I don't know, you know, what will happen.
So the stall is because we publicly announced 7:20 as a start time. So we have to wait till 7:20 so that we hold our word.
To generate, to get from a like a geotechnical, like a soil analysis, probably $2,000 to $5,000 depending on the complexity.
I will say this is not particularly about the project, but there was some generic stormwater material in the package tonight that was literally a follow-on to what we did last board meeting. It was very not specific to the project, but it was just sort of a primer about some aspects of soils and all of that. And I was thinking that would be interesting to sort of set aside and keep.
Just remember to pull up the project. And the applicant hasn't seen this because I've been reading all afternoon. I just got these late this afternoon.
Okay, will you summarize them for us?
Yeah.
For him?
Yeah. Okay.
Clock on the wall says 7:20.
19.
Yeah.
John's clock says 7:20. Okay, I'd like to open a 7:20 site plan for a new two-family at 111 North Main Street, Florence, map ID 17C-240, presentation.
Hi, I'm Terry Reynolds from T. Reynolds Engineering. We're representing Jim Mayo, his two sons, who are interested in building two-family at 111 North Main Street. Currently what's proposed are two units, one in the front, where I'm showing here, and one in the back. They're both approximately 1,500 square feet, both floors, two floors. There's a central garage with a space each for each unit, right in the middle. And then there's parking for another space outside in front of each unit, one here and one over here. And basically, there will be parking in the garage, and cars can back out of the garage and then drive out. And if they're in these spaces, they can back into the garage space and drive out that way. Generally, there's an existing sidewalk. This was an existing house here that was a gentleman who had a little problem with it burning. So that's been torn down, and currently it's just waiting to have something new rebuilt on it. The house, I said each one's about 1,500 square feet. It's a 15-foot side setback here, but because this rear unit has the rear sort of facing the side, we're required to put up a buffer along the edge. So we've got arborvitae proposed here and here, and in the middle we've got some ornamental plantings behind the existing garage, so to allow for that. Basically paved driveway on it, with the front entrance here facing the road and it's coming out to the sidewalk, and then there are side entrances, full covered porches wrap around on the front unit, and then a covered porch on the side unit, on the back unit rather. Then a grading plan here. So for the stormwater, the building's being managed to meet the pre and post conditions out here, with no increase in runoff going off the site. Dealing with all the roof runoffs mainly being collected into a infiltration galley up here in the northwest corner of the site. That's through a just a pickup line that wraps around the whole building. And that's pretty much the extent of it. And I'll just put it up for any questions.
Okay. Alan.
I like the design. I like the way you, it's actually the side of the building facing the street that you made it look like the front. The open space, you have 45%. And, I mean, I'm sure your computer figured it out, and I assume it's correct, but it's just surprising looking at it. So is all of the parking and the parking area and driveway and going into the garage, that's all bituminous?
Yes.
So obviously that's excluded from open space. So
right.
The only open space is the backyard and the north side and that tiny bit
you've got open space across the front.
Yeah.
Wrapping all the way around and coming around the backyard. There's green space along the front of the porch here, and green space along the front of the front porch along the side.
Works out to 45%.
Yeah, that was a calculation. Yeah.
I never would have guessed it just eyeballing it, but I guess I'm wrong. Yeah. Thanks.
Have you given any thought to making that a pervious driveway? Because you're gonna, I mean, the water calculations now are gonna, you know, gonna charge you for not having that covered. Do I have that right?
Hmm? The stormwater fee will be related to the impervious cover.
Yep.
Yeah.
But does a gravel driveway change that story?
Not gravel. You have to build you have to build an actual, what would be considered semi-pervious surface. You couldn't just put gravel on. You have to. It has to be structured so that it does infiltrate.
It would be a designed driveway.
Yeah.
And it becomes tricky because the soils in the rear of the site aren't really suitable.
Yeah.
So
they are as part of the stormwater, which I don't know if you went into detail. There's capturing most of the roof runoff and bringing it to an infiltration chamber at the front.
Yep. Right.
So that that's a direct recharge onto the site, as opposed to just allowing a gutter system to sheet flow mm-hmm. on the ground.
But on the back side of the...
Originally had a smaller galley set up.
Actually, it's probably...
This is just a technical update on the top.
A smaller what set up?
So, originally, we had just one single galley. And expanded it to two.
Sorry.
So the back of the lot is dropping. What are you doing to capture
it
that?
It drops down about 3 feet.
All right.
Yeah.
And what are you doing to capture that?
To capture the water going to the back?
Uh-huh.
We're matching what was going to the back of the lot. So there's no increase in flow going to the back of the lot.
Yeah. Do you have some DPW comments about that?
I do. So the DPW sent all of their comments about water, sewer, stormwater, and trees late this afternoon. I just forwarded to the applicant, so I don't think they've seen those. But I can read through them. There's some... technical sort of heads up water issues about connecting 3/4-inch copper pipe in accordance with their standards for the water line, and about how to distribute the water meters depending on how the ownership is distributed. And then for sewer, sort of similar, wanting connections, obviously in accordance with the city standards for how to expose the existing sewer stubs and that kind of thing, and then rebuilding. I don't think you all need to condition that because that, once they come to the DPW to tie in, they have to follow these criteria. For stormwater, the comment is the property owner must inspect and maintain the proposed stormwater management system to ensure that the system functions according to the design and in good working condition, and then ask that a condition be put on that prior to start of construction or issuance of a building permit, the applicant must submit a stormwater management operation and maintenance plan that defines the long-term operation of that infiltration chamber at the front. So that we just have it on file. So this, and let me just back up, this did not require a separate stormwater permit. It's a small, very small scale project. It doesn't even require a stormwater analysis under zoning. It's not a major project, it's an intermediate project. So at 5,000 square feet and above is when an applicant needs to submit a full stormwater analysis. And then, so that, gap between 5,000 square feet of construction and then 1 acre of disturbance is where the planning board would see a full stormwater assessment and then DPW's comments back after an acre of disturbance, then that's a completely separate permit that the applicant would need to obtain from the DPW. This is under three, you know, this is about 3,000 square feet, so it's well under the 5,000, but the applicant went ahead and submitted quite extensive analysis for this scale of project and showing the infiltration chamber. So DPW's comments are very specific to this, but I just wanted to be clear that it's not a separate permit. So they're giving you their feedback and recommendations about how to, you want to make sure that the system as they've shown it will continue to function over a long period of time.
What was that, the qualification they need to submit the O&M like manual prior to what?
Prior to either start of construction or issuance of a building permit. So depending on which one comes first. And
isn't it clear which one comes first?
Well, sometimes some will pull a building permit before they start site work. Other times people start site work and don't actually file for their building permit. So it's just a matter of making sure before any work begins.
I'm sorry, maybe I missed it. You said either whichever comes first, building permit or start of construction?
Right, site work. I should have clarified.
Site work.
Yeah.
So at a break, let me explain that we've got a presentation and then we ask our questions and then I'll open it up for public comment and you get your chance to speak and ask questions, and we'll probably leave that public comment open as we take it back and ask some questions. So it's coming.
So the revisions to the proposed system, the plans you have just received, shows an increase to the size of the stormwater system to capture the flows from a large portion of the proposed building roof and infiltrate the volume of up to 100-year design storm. The area of the roof flowing to the proposed system matches the proposed increased impervious area on the site. So that new impervious area from the existing conditions is all being brought to that infiltration chamber. And then the final two comments about the trees in the back. There are two significant trees of 20-inch and 36 diameter breast height maples. Shall be protected with a chain link fencing at a radius of 18 feet from the trunk during construction. And if encroachment for grading or whatever site work needs to be done within that fence line, then the requirements for tree protection as described in ANSI 300 Part 5, which is referenced in the significant tree ordinance, shall apply and be implemented. And then the final is just a note about addressing the way that DPW is going to do the street numbering.
Okay. Does that raise any questions with anyone?
Just in terms of the stormwater, the reason we did do the analysis like this is there was concern that we would be causing an impact to the neighbors, and that's why we showed this.
Well, and I think we probably need to keep in mind that the single family house that was there was using the city water. I mean, it was not doing anything extra to remediate itself. So there's some of that to play. I'm happy to hear. I didn't know the two large trees were in the back. I'm happy to hear that because I was bothered by the planting plan just showing the new additional hedgerows. And
that's why you see the grading the way it is. The grading's pushed back, so we're trying not to kill those trees.
Okay.
So.
Yeah, we'd love to keep them.
Anne? Is this single family zoning or duplex by
B?
It's URB, so allowed by right are single, two, and three family. But once you're over 2,000 square feet and you're more than a single family, then that's what brought the project here as a site plan review by the planning board.
But there are no exceptions to the size and scale on the lot or or the frontage or anything else.
Any other questions about this? Yes, thank you, Mark. Anyone from the public want to ask questions or have a statement? And if you do, we'd appreciate your name for the minutes and direction.
My name is Ron White, and I prepared a statement that I'd like to read.
What's your address, Mr. White?
It's part of the statement.
Okay.
I realize that. But I wanted to just say it, I'm sharing my opinions and my history as being a resident of the area for a number of years. So my name is Ron White. My wife and I live at 117 North Main Street in Florence, and this has been our home since 1982. Tonight, as an abutter to 111 North Main Street, I would like to address the proposed project before you. We would like to have a new home built next to us, and it would be a good thing for our neighborhood, and it would give closure to a period in time we all would like to move on from. But I will be candid here in that our vision of what is appropriate for this building site and the developer's vision are at opposite points of the spectrum. Right? It's such a small lot of land, one of the smallest on North Main Street, deserves a respectably sized single-family home or a more traditional two-family home so as to be in harmony with the rest of the neighborhood. This proposal of two townhouses, and I believe they're townhouses, not a two-family home, with garages, more than doubles in size the former Zygmunt home. It eliminates green space on the site, creating an awkward balance between the massive building structure in relation to functional open space. The charm of Florence and Northampton is the openness and green space that it allows its residents to interact with their neighbors or to relax in the privacy of their home and yard. It's called quality of life. Do we need to sacrifice this to profit margins and tax revenue? I sure hope not. I am a realist and know that given the way the bylaw has been structured and the past performance of this board relative to infill, there is little anyone can do to contest a project that carries the phrase right to build. Even so, there are issues and questions with the site that need to be put forth, and I have three things that concern me beyond the disproportional size of the townhouses that have been proposed. The first issue deals with traffic and parking on Bardwell Street. The street over the years has become highly used by commuters trying to avoid the traffic lights in Florence Center. It is also a major access for commercial vehicles making deliveries to Florence Casket Company and the large number of companies located in the magnet machinery complex. Additionally, we have the ambulance service that is in the old magnet building. Bardwell Street is their main route to access North Main Street when answering their emergency calls. I'm concerned that additional off-street parking by visitors from 111 North Main Street could complicate traffic flow on the street and add potential problems with the intersection of North Main and Bardwell. The second you've discussed to a point, and I don't fully understand it, it has to do with the subsurface retention pod on the site and the proximity to my lot line. I would like to know is, can you guarantee that this pod will never max out an overflow? And if not, why is the pod placed so close to a lot line without a method to divert the overflow to an area that that will have less potential to do harm? And lastly, there is a historical water issue with this site. Between the four abutting properties lies a natural basin which has been and still is a water collection area. I have witnessed the varying degrees of water in the backyard of 111 North Main Street over the past 35 years. My neighbors know of it, the Zygmunts know of it, there are some DPW employees who are aware of it, and as abutters we have dealt with this in our own way. Water that runs off from the properties naturally, as well as added runoff from the magnet machinery, bike path, parking area, and even the intersection of North Main Street and Bardwell have to varying degrees contributed to water problems especially to the backyard of 111 North Main Street. Over the years, the former Zygmunt property has had standing water in the backyard, occasional water in its cellar floor, and in August of 1996, a full-out flooded backyard and basement, resulting in the Northampton Fire Department assisting by pumping out the water from the site and the building. In this instance, much of the water source was from the backed-up stormwater system that routinely causes the intersection of North Main and Bardwell to flood in cases of severe rain. I witnessed the water rise over the curb and enter my property paralleling Bardwell Street. The water then followed the contour of my land, being pulled as if siphoned to the back of my property and eventually into the Zygmunt's backyard. Granted, this was a severe storm, but it has happened once and could happen again. We've had close calls, especially the storms of 2000 and 2014. Considering the regularity of severe storms following the Route 9 corridor towards us, I wouldn't want to bet against this event repeating again. Consider this. The original home of the Zygmunts was approximately 51 to 56 feet from its front boundary line to the home's back wall. Its entire basement and backyard were flooded with a minimum of 1 foot of water in 1996. The first proposed townhouse unit is approximately 54 feet from its front boundary line to the common wall between the two garages. This would put the entire second townhouse in the heart of the water collection area. The site plan has made attempts to control the runoff associated with the structures by using subtle grading, the retention pod, gutters, but all this doesn't account for the large volume of impervious concrete that is sitting on a collection area that retains water. What is going to happen with the next big storm? Impervious concrete will likely cause water displacement. Does it go away from the townhouses to the abutters' property, or will it enter the new home that may have been built in harm's way? These are my thoughts and questions. I'm not an engineer. I'm a layperson trying to use common sense and foresight to encourage people to take a closer look, to think outside the box rather than just following the black and white text that is used to write a bylaw, to use your best judgment to determine the suitability of this site for the contractor's proposed project. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else want to speak?
Can I ask a question?
Yes. Well, oh. Come on up. We'll ask a question. Sure.
I just had a question to Carolyn.
Yep.
What is the definition of a two-family home?
Well, it can be used quite generally as two units in the structure. Both these units are attached. So in Northampton.
Attached by a garage.
Attached by a garage. In Northampton, we have a specific definition about townhouses, that they're are at least two units attached to each other, and they're upstairs, downstairs units, as opposed to one unit on top of the other. So that's a very specific to Northampton. The whole world doesn't think that way. two units are allowed. It could be in a townhouse form, meaning side by side, or one inside another building.
Thank you. Your name and address.
Hi. I'm Pam Powers, and I live at 105 North Main Street. I'm on the other side of the property, on the other side of the Zygmunt property, and I abut the property just as the Whites do. So the second townhouse that's more or less away from the street is essentially set up so that match up with the end of where my house is, the outline of my house is. I have no problems with the project, and I am looking forward to having something be on the site on that particular location, but I share the concern about where is the water going to go. Where that second townhouse is located is exactly where the sitting water that Mr. White talked about would be collecting. And about, I'm not good at measurements, but about right at the property line at the back between where Mr. Zygmunt's property is and the Quinn's property is the major collection point, which is right in my backyard. Along one side of my property, there's a retaining wall that's been built, a stone wall, which is about 2.5 feet high, and the water has gotten up that high. So, and it's been more than once that the water has collected in that particular area. The way that the water collects is from all the properties, I think in four or five houses in that area, and it collects right in that backyard. So just to give you an idea, my kids have gotten tops of plastic tubs out to wade their way across that standing water. It's just 2.5 feet deep times, you know, the high entire width of my backyard. I'm not against building on that lot. I would like to, you know, have my comments reflect that I want to protect, you know, the landowners who bought the property as much as I want to protect my own property. I just want you to have my comments in the record to know that, you know, there is a concern in the neighborhood. We're looking forward to, you know, having there be an appropriate style building structure on that particular site. But you do need to be aware that there is an issue with the water. And, you know, the question that we all have is, when you put a house right where that standing water was before, where is that water going to go afterwards? So thank you for your time.
Thank you. Any other? Yeah.
My name is Richard Hurdle, and I live at 108 North Main Street. I live across the street. I, too, have been aware of the flooding issues that have gone on across on the old Zygmunt property. In looking over the plans that have been shown tonight, they're a departure from what was released on the website. So you have done some updating. You said you changed the ponding or the leach galley, made it larger and so forth. I have a few technical questions about the analysis. Good. One of them, it says that the type of soil that is this property is being built on is a weakly loamy soil, and the description that you provided in the technical package of your analysis made the following statements about the properties and qualities. The slope can be no more between 0 and 3%. It says that frequency of flooding, none. Frequency of ponding, none. And the limiting layer to transmitting water out from the area is at 1.42 inches per hour. Most of your calculations are higher than that minimum level. And I just like to know why you exceeded the minimum level for the drainage capacity of that soil.
Excuse me.
And
you're speaking to us.
Okay. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yes. Well, it all relates to their water analysis or the portion of that presentation, and how the depiction of the soil in that area is different than what has been observed by us in the neighborhood. It does have frequent ponding. It is prone to flooding. And we wonder how the calculations could be made based on those numbers as the cited soil type.
Right.
And I think that would have an impact on the analysis. There are a few other things about the drawing package. In particular, in the site plan on page 2 of 3, note 6 on the original one, it said that you will obtain a 3% grade from all parts of the structure away from the building to prevent water from backing up inside the building. I see areas, especially in that garage area, going off to the neighbor's property where there's less than a 3% grade. So that is going to be an issue, how you meet that 3% grade requirement. It also shows in your building plan that there's no gas line going into the property. There was gas in the original home. Is gas going to be used in this home as well? Or are you planning to use bottle gas for heating, or are you going to use electricity for heating? Let's see. Oh, the other thing, in all of your analyses, the 2, 10, and 100-year rates, you chose a nominal rate and not the 90% rate for the amount of, or the rate at which water would be present on the property. I just wondered how your analysis would reflect if you chose the 90%, not the average. And let's see, I have one more page of questions. Just one second. Sorry about that. Oh, also in your elevation plan that was provided with the drawing package, it showed a dormer that looked like the dormer was on the front of the property, yet in your other parts of your package where you showed the water runoff on the roof, it looks like the dormer was actually on the back unit because you actually had a sculpture out there to take and account for the water runoff from the peaked portion of that roof, this right here. And my question is, it looks like the drawing that was shown on the screen has the dormer on the front of the building. Which is correct? Is it the drawing that you're now showing or the drawing in the original package that, or the plan that you had for the water runoff containment? So there were just inconsistencies in the materials, and apparently they've updated the design, which we wonder how long it will be before that design will be up on the website so it too can be reviewed and looked at.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Anyone else? Yes, sir.
I'm just getting up to let him in.
Okay. Anyone else want to speak before we go back to a round of questioning of the applicant?
I'll answer for the heating and the gas.
Okay.
As far as the gas, I'm in touch with Bay State and whether they, with a, they got a moratorium going on, whether I can get it to the building. If they'll hook me back up, it's still up in the air.
Yeah.
But I'm planning on doing the high efficiency mini splits with electric baseboard heating as a backup.
Yeah, they're treating each of those on a case-by-case basis, and you might have some luck because there was a load, you know, there is a capacity in the line that came to the old house. Any other questions after the round of public? Carolyn?
I thought you were going to say something. I'm curious to hear the applicant respond to some of these questions. Mm-hmm. Did the DPW, did they make any reference to the grade issues or the soil issues as far as what was taken to generate the calculations used versus reality as far as ponding or flooding and so forth?
No, not specifically. The engineer can speak to that, but there are different soils depending on which part of the site you're looking at. So the grade is obviously different in the back than it is in the front. It's very flat in the front, which is where they're proposing to put the infiltration chamber. Mm-hmm. So that probably accounts for the differences because it's very you know, soils change all over the site, not just here, but everywhere.
But I do remember reading the stormwater runoff analysis only showed a type A soil.
Okay, well, you can have the applicants. Yeah.
Okay, want to take a crack at it?
Yeah, the reason is basically the soil mapping shows the entire area is type A soil. And so...
Did you dig test pit?
We did. And so the soils in the back of the site are fill soils. There's a lot of junk dumped in there. And that's why I don't know to what extent for me to know. I'd have to go and dig throughout the neighborhood. So when you do these analyses, you have to go with the soil mapping for the areas. Generally, that's the standard. And so in citing the infiltration units there, basically we did test pits in the back, we did test pits in the front, and we did test pits adjacent to the old driveway. And the soils in the back were poor. They weren't suitable for doing infiltration at all. So, you know, I could say, okay, well, I could model it as, you know, poor soils. You're going to get the same outcome if you model it as poor soils or as good, you know, because if you say, okay, this area is D, we're going to fill over it, then it's still D, and it's just not going to infiltrate the same. So it's, and to what extent? Am I going to poke holes every 10 feet through the property? So it's kind of, you know, the general is you go with the USDA mapping. USDS mapping.
I go with test pits. How many did you dig?
Three.
Okay.
This is a 0.2 acre property.
Yep, I'll give you that, yes.
But I think the issue is where the system is going is where the test was done. So DPW relies on not the general map that's done by the survey, but what's done on the ground, right. Site specific. Yeah.
And that's why that's located where it is, because where it is, it actually turns back to what you expect for Hinkley sands.
Okay. Ann?
How much water is the catch thing in the front going to hold at any given time?
It's an infiltration gap.
I know.
So it's not going to hold much at all. You know, you've got 3 4-by-4-foot galleys in there with stone around them. So, you know, you've got... 16 times 3.
Whatever. And it's draining out to?
And it infiltrates.
The surrounding soil.
Just into the soil.
Yeah.
Sexy.
I think that's the explanation I was missing a minute ago. That's why the soil's quality matters there.
Yeah.
Right. I guess just follow Ann's question. But that's capturing from the structure.
Yes, basically the almost the entire roof area is being collected and infiltrated. So, you know, for instance, you know, there's a concern that we're taking away that ponded area. Well, the ponded area was a real problem for the previous house because you had a walk-in basement down there and it just flooded right into the basement. So there's no way you wanted that. That was a real problem. You know, I did speak with Doug McDonald, and he said that there is a, I'm sorry, Mr. White?
Yes.
Yeah, he told him that there is an issue with water coming over the barred well. So DPW is aware of that and is looking into that. In terms of the runoff from the site, you know, we're reducing the actual area that runs off, that's actually running off the site to start with.
And this may, I'm just trying to understand, and I don't know what, I mean, I drive by there several times a week, I live out in Leeds, so what has been happening to the water when there's been nothing there?
I don't know that anything, I haven't seen ponding out there, if that's what you mean.
You can ask these guys, I mean, I haven't seen,
standing water.
We've been in a drought for a year.
Right. But we have had some rainstorms. So I guess I'm just trying to understand what's going to be.
Site right now is fully exposed.
Right.
And the front half of the site are nice medium sands. The back of the site is fill and debris. And that's most likely why it was ponding, is because it was if you dig deep enough in other areas, you're probably going to find decent material. But that particular area, for some reason, was disturbed.
Right now, there is standing water where the back of the old Zygmunt house would be at the moment.
And so is there like frozen puddle back there or something?
Well, it's not frozen, but it's a puddle of probably 15 feet in diameter.
Okay,
John? So, I'm sorry, just one more. So as you looked at the site, I mean, it sounds like part of it is water that's related to the site, but part of it's water that's coming to the site. I mean, and those are two different things. But.
Yeah, and there's a low area that basically, so what we're talking about is a low area that was here that would flood. But the low area extends, and it kind of extends across sort of this way, across the neighborhood. And this is the area that, I'm sorry, I forgot. Hamp was talking about that was flooding, so it floods back here also during, you know, more extreme events. So this whole back area has a history of flooding.
When the house was up, the water from the roof of that house went down drains. Did it go into the city or did it just go onto the property?
Well, the front of the site went to the road, the front of the house, and portions of that roof. And it's in the drainage report. There's a drainage area map that looks at that. And then the rear all went to the rear of the site. The back of the house, basically probably 2/3 to 3/4 of the property went to the back of the site.
And all of that is now being drained away?
Well, the majority of that's going in, either coming off to the front,
right,
or going into the infiltration system.
Not so, going into the back, so it's being drained away.
So now what goes to the back is this northern edge and the eastern edge here.
Alan?
Yeah, how confident, a couple questions. How confident are you that the proposed plan, the way you deal with the water, will not exacerbate the problem that's been there historically? What's your level of confidence about that? And would it improve your confidence if you were to install 4 chambers or 5 chambers instead of 3?
No, it wouldn't.
Why not?
Well, for one, I don't know how much is coming from this property or that property. To try to turn this whole area into an infiltration galley to control the neighborhood just isn't realistic.
Well, no, of course. I'm just asking about the runoff from
the site itself.
How confident are you that the 3 chambers you're proposing will take care of the problem so it won't be any worse?
Well, I mean, what we're proposing here is handling the site. What happens off the site, I can't control.
I understand that.
So. I'm confident that those galleys are going to be able to handle the 100-year event, from those roof areas.
So the construction of the project then would not make the water any worse in the neighborhood for the abutters.
You know, in terms of the low area, we are removing some of that low area. So I can't say to what extent, I don't know what extent the flooding is in the neighborhood. I haven't experienced that. I know that low area extends. What the volume of the low area back there is would take a larger analysis of the entire neighborhood to really know where that flooding is going to be.
I guess I'm not, maybe I just don't understand enough about the subject matter, but I'm not talking about the neighborhood generally, of course. That's not the applicant's problem. But the immediate abutter and the potential runoff from the construction of this project is my question. And whether you're confident that with the three chambers you're installing, you will not be aggravating the existing problem.
I guess, you know, all I can say is this project, the low area for the neighborhood is the backyard of this house. And that's why this house was having the flooding problems it had. And so, yes, we are taking away a low area that may have taken the neighborhood, the bulk of the neighborhood volume. And I guess it's to you, is he supposed to continue being the detention basin for the neighborhood?
So it's conceivable it could make it worse.
It's just by virtual building anything here. Push it somewhere else. Right. Yeah.
Dan?
Well, I think trying to re-paraphrase it maybe for understanding, the project is actually not going to add more. It's going to reduce the amount of water that's contributed to the back of the property.
That's what I was going to say.
But the construction itself is going to eliminate some retention that it currently exists because of natural topography. So it's a balance, and I don't think it's really possible to say what the net impact is going to be because you have no idea.
That's what I'm saying. I would have to evaluate the entire neighborhood to really know.
But the property, the project itself is actually going to improve the amount of water that goes back there, and you could conclude that that will be in and of itself a significant improvement.
I do think it's unusual for us to have a stormwater management plan for a two-family. That's a very unusual situation for us. As far as thinking about what the engineering work is on this, I think you could kind of look around at us and realize that we're going to rely on the DPW review of the stormwater management plan. I mean, those are the specialists. And in fact, we called Doug McDonald in for the last meeting to explain to us how he goes about reviewing those plans, because there had been a previous project that was concerned about whether the city had the ability to review the proposed work that goes in. So the plan that came with the project is reviewed by DPW, and those were the comments that Carolyn was speaking out loud, because the timing is such that he hadn't had a chance to see them today. So DPW finished them at the end of the day, and then Carolyn's in a meeting. So I think I'm left with the retention of water on site is better than running off, and you're doing that in a way that it wasn't done in the previous property. There's nothing about the scale or size of the house that our zoning leads us to counter. We allow this. We do have gone about adopting infill where we can, and so two parcels on this property fit the rules. Not parcels, but two living spaces. I'm wondering if anyone else, other than the water, is there anything else that anyone else wants to cover? Is that really where we're down to?
My only would be is it's it, to me it's stretching the definition of a two-family home. Citizen was right. I mean, there's a lot of two-family homes on that stretch, and they don't look like this. Even though I know that I think by regulation they are allowable. When I saw the description that described it as a two-family, I kind of looked at it like, well, wait a minute, that's not a two-family. Those are two houses, and they just happen to share a garage. But I know by definition that they meet it. But I do think. I'll be curious to see how it fits once, if in fact it's there, because to me, it's not a two-family per that neighborhood, and it's gonna look different.
It's architecturally different, no matter how you would clump it together. It's always going to look different.
I mean, it's
different.
Brand new. I mean, yeah.
Well, it's just going to be architecturally different than what's around it. If the two houses were absolutely next to one another and the garages were on the outside or whatever, it would still look different.
So maybe to help as well with the definition, I mean, the intent partially in changing the zoning was not to get, to sort of be more flexible about units and not be stuck on definitions of whether it's a two-family or two townhouse units attached, because the concept is give flexibility to allow two units in any way that makes sense for different sites, for different parts. So I think in this zoning district, as opposed to saying two families are allowed, you get one, two, or three units by right. Once you're beyond three units, the zoning in this district requires them to be side-by-side units, so you can't build an apartment building or a multifamily building with four units all shared in one. They really need to be separate and attached to make it potentially feel like it fits more in with the rhythm of the URB district, which tends to be two-story, historically two-story sort of home. So I guess I would say the zoning wasn't intended to say, by definition, you can have this type of two-family versus another type.
Well, and the one thing, I like the way they've honored the front street.
Oh, yeah. No,
right.
That's, so there are some things about the design I do like.
And then just to another point on the units, by right also you're allowed a single family with an attached accessory apartment. So in another scenario, you could build the front unit, put a garage, and then put an apartment on the back, and it wouldn't even come before you. Mm-hmm. And the single family could be twice the size of this single family, as long as they didn't exceed the 40% open space threshold. So that may be another way for everyone to sort of think about that the real, whether it's arbitrary or not, the threshold is that it's a full, two-unit, two-family type of structure as opposed to a single with an accessory apartment.
Well, and the distinction between whether we're saying it is a two-family, a townhouse, or an accessory apartment doesn't change the ability to build there.
Right.
This might be outside the scope of this, but if one of the family members were to sell their half of this, their unit, how does that affect the management of the water?
They'll have,
it's not a condo.
They'll have,
yeah.
It's not a condo.
Well, you'd have to.
No, but I have to comply. If you buy. Buyer have to comply to, with whatever rules.
I think if they were to include in the bylaws, the responsibility.
Yeah, whether it's a condo or not, yeah. I think is
irrelevant. The permit goes with the land, the entire thing. So whoever the subsequent owners are, buy into that responsibility.
Yeah. I can't imagine that a subsequent owner would buy in unless they had some condo papers or something that spelled out the separation of the two properties. But it's a good thought to think ahead, because that is what happens. Right. They do transition over time.
One other note from the staff memo with regard to traffic and trip generation, there was a note about increase of one peak hour trip per new unit in the traffic impact fee, and that this parcel owner would pay a traffic impact fee of $1,000, or that we may condition that, just to help offset an increase in, in new trips happening to and from the site.
So what are you saying?
The recommendation is that we condition the payment, the payment of traffic mitigation fee for $1,000.
They offer that.
So. That's just to speak to, there was public concern about increase in, with a two-family from a single-family, more trips.
One more trip isn't going to make any difference on that street.
I just want trying to understand. So when there is a flood in there, all the three properties share that permeability. Is that what it is? Because the second house unit is the one that is blocking is.
the permeability, right?
He's taking that.
So when there is a flood, all the other two properties on the back here, do they share the because the water comes and accumulate, right? The accumulated water is just on this plot in the corner here, or the other properties share?
The other properties have some, the adjacent properties share that in terms of it extends across this way. There's a low area that goes across behind the property. So it'll still be flooding kind of over in here. To what extent? That's what we're talking about. It's really hard to know if it's going to be any worse or not.
And I'm asking because
the other thing that we're not seeing is there an outlet over here for it to go somewhere?
There isn't.
So. Now, I'm asking because if the ceilings retain all the water for their property that's been covered, I understand that if you make that impermeable, that area, whatever the other two lots, you get more water. I mean, because if that corner was helping with the drainage.
No.
What is just on?
It's not draining in that problem, which is why it collects there. And when they add the roof and the roofing and the gutter system, it's going to actually shunt all that water.
Yeah. So
it does improve. The construction improves it.
That's why they're sending proofs. But and would that compensate whatever the amount of water that these will absorb without any unity here? If you know what I'm trying to say.
Well, I mean, it's reducing the amount of water from this site that goes into the flooded area. And that's all I can really say to it.
So he's taking
picking up all the roof runoff, which is a significant portion of that back area.
Mm-hmm. And describe to me what the ground view of those filtration pits look like.
This is a detail of it.
Right.
So basically you have your galley with an open bottom here, and it is basically surrounded with stone.
Yep.
And so it basically fills up and it's perforated, and so it filters out into the stone and then infiltrates through the sides and the bottom.
Okay, thank you.
And so you have storage volume within the galleys as part of the thing, the stone.
And that's what gives it the time to get into the stone.
Right.
Right.
But it's completely underground. So
yes.
I'll promise I'll get to you both. Mark?
Just, I think the concern, so everything that hits the roof, if it works right, is grabbed by a gutter and sent to the galley system.
Underground.
And out.
Yeah.
So that's great. But around the perimeter, it sheds off. Whereas before it collected, now it's shedding away. So the potential for the neighbors is to aggravate what is already a bad situation. So you want the slope to shed away from the house, obviously, so it's not coming into the basement. There's no basement here, right?
These are going to have basements. They're going to have sumps in them.
Yeah. Okay.
Could you say how deep the basement is? Is it 6 to 8 feet?
The basement?
Yeah.
The basement's going to be, it's a standard basement.
6 to 8 feet.
Well, yeah.
Okay. Mr. White, you had a hand up?
Well, my concern is gentleman, who I don't remember the name, Mr. Reynolds. I asked initially whether there could be a guarantee that there wouldn't be any overflow of the retention pipe.
Of the galleys.
All right, of the galleys. And as I'm listening even further, my concern is that large volume of water is going to be underground, right? I don't know if that top portion of the pod that I look at is a relief valve.
No, that's just access.
Right, so then my next thing is, if you're throwing all that water in that one area, what's the possibility of it starts to undercut my driveway?
It's not going to. I mean, it's basically, it's filled with stone.
Okay.
The sand can't come into it. And so it's not going to, you're not going to suddenly get a sinkhole or anything
well,
like
that's,
that.
That's my concern.
It's standard groundwater flow. And the gradient is obviously going to go under the road and down. That's the gradient for the water in that area going to the field.
You want to sign off on that one?
That would be my best engineering guess.
Yeah, guess.
Yep. One more question.
Without doing actual borings through across the, you know.
Do you want a hammer? Do you remember her name?
Pam.
Okay. Pam. Pam, you raise your hand.
So, you know, just to give you more of a visual here, if you, as far as the grade goes, because I think Mr. White and his neighbor behind him are really going to be impacted by the flow going off of the roof and settling into some area. If you can imagine a big basin where these five properties, the grade goes down eventually, and if you looked, they're all even on North Main Street, but as you walk back towards the back of the property, the grade starts to go down and down and down. It just so happens, I don't know, my neighbors might know this more than me, that our property has a retaining wall and it goes flat and then it cuts down about 2 feet. And that water will sit up there at 2 feet high in the back of my property and it goes somewhere. It doesn't go out into the street, it goes into either the neighbor's yards or eventually gets seeped into the land. So it, you know, the way that you were describing it is actually going to make it worse for the property owners whose landscape is the equivalent of what's here. So.
Okay, thank you. Any other thoughts from the board? Any other questions of the applicant?
Can I ask Carolyn a question?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
If the previous owner was still there, and the house was still there, and there was this indentation in their backyard, and they decided to landscape their yard and make it flat, would they have to get anybody's permission to do that?
No. Oh. In fact, I think that, you know, I would speculate that that's what the retaining wall is. It's that landfill that was put in the back to level the lot.
Right. Yeah. So I think that goes back to Dan's point about it's just an accident of topography that this particular property happens to be the low point or the gathering place for a network of.
Yes, but I mean the applicant has to ensure that they don't make the situation worse, and so that's the retention water that's the solution of I'm putting in more roof, but I'm handling it in a better way than it was
right.
handled by
right.
the previous structure.
Right.
The other thing also about the, you know, this is designed to the 100-year storm. That's a significant storm event. So
right.
that's far more than anybody else in that area. And there will be water in the back no matter what when you have a storm of that, you know, size. So and the soils, you know, it's confirmed the soils in the back are not good for drainage. So that's why they sit there. The water sits there. But as explained, all the water from this project and previously is going to the front now instead of draining the way it historically has been. You know, I think 75% or something, he said, was going to the back. All of that now is no longer the case. So, in essence, there could be a little bit more storage in the back if you're taking what was there before and putting it to the front.
Plus, there'll be a new basement, which there's all kinds of retention there.
Like a magnet for one.
Yeah.
Yes.
I have I know. Out of curiosity. So, you know, a lot of times with projects like this, you know, we hear about the stormwater system and about DPW's requests that there be a management plan to make sure the system is functioning as designed. How do you know if it's not functioning as designed? Like, when, you know, when you said there's that little top of it to kind of like look in and check on it, does it look like it's always filled up or like, you know?
Yeah, I mean, basically anything like that, you open it up and see that it's draining adequately.
Okay.
And so, you could determine that it had gotten filled with silt itself.
Right. Yeah, I mean, so
okay. water in the backyard or in other yards doesn't mean that it's not working.
No, I mean, that's a whole separate issue.
And yeah. That was something DPW in the last notes of today was looking for some type of documentation or some type of maintenance log.
So spell out instructions essentially for the next homeowners to say, here's what you need to do and here's the time period in which you need to do them.
One of the things, you know, that will be done on it are putting screens on the gutters so you don't end up with leaves and crap going down the gutters, that sort of thing. Trying to ensure that you just get good, clean water in there. And that's because you don't want to be digging them up. I mean, these are pretty inexpensive, fortunately. They're locally made up in Haydenville. But, you know, you don't want to be digging them up.
So. Okay, one last round, sir.
Okay, I have a question.
Mm-hmm.
Are you willing to put a test before you complete and sign off on everything? You bring out a fire truck and dump X number of gallons per hour into that device?
We would not put anyone through that.
What that's based on is there's been long-term testing depending on the material type, and that's how that was designed. It's based on a sand, long-term acceptance rates of sand. So it's ideally a conservative number. That is the standard.
Yeah, I think for the confidence of what the project is intended to do, I'm relying on the DPW engineers. That really is what I must do. And so I must say I don't know that we could design our own test that would tell us much. So it's an idea, I get it, but I think I'm comfortable with the DPW's analysis, and I do think that it's a problematic lot. It sounds like it's a problematic problem to the neighborhood, but he's bought the lot. He has the right to build within the rules of our town, and I think the assignment is don't make it worse, and that really is kind of how the zoning is written. Wait a minute, Mark.
I'm struggling with the don't make it worse thing. I get the system as designed, if it operates, it's going to make what falls from the sky collected, it'll be collected in a better manner. My concern is the lot itself was a low spot, so throughout the neighborhood it would come to that and settle. Now it's going to come to that and get sent back because the grading is shedding it that way. So I think it's going to make what's falling on that lot will be made better, but at the expense of the neighbors as far as the running water on the surface of the abutters. And I'm wondering if a swale could be made around the perimeter or almost like a footing drain or something to so it's you're not actively shedding water from the property away to the neighbors, so you're not making that situation worse. You know what I mean? I mean, it's unusual to have a groundwater study, a stormwater study for a project this size, but the reason we have it is because this is a problem site. And we went through the Barrett Street, we talked to Doug McDonald, and I think we're in this gray area that zoning-wise and setbacks and everything, they're meeting everything. But there's still a problem there. And I think if we just say, well, the DPW says it's gonna be okay, if this thing works like the engineer says it's gonna work, then it's gonna be okay, and that's all we can do about it. But I think based on past experience, there's the one in Bay State, we had the same issue with water. Barrett Street was all about water, and everything met all the standards that they had to meet, and this one does too. But that doesn't mean it's not a problem. And so I'm wondering if, and I don't know, Carolyn, what capacity we have to almost like a light layout. You know, the light's got to be zero at the plot line. can the water flow from the surface be zero at the perimeter of the plot? Can we collect it? Can we make that a condition to, you know,
well,
where is that?
I guess the problem with that is that historically, the water doesn't stay on the site. It's shed to the back and it eventually percolated down, or maybe it flowed a little bit to the abutting parcel. So I don't know that, I suppose, you can ask the engineer if the very small amount of additional water that's going to the back, if that could be, you know, captured in a swale around the one edge. I don't know if you could grade it that way, or at least at the, I mean, I think the issue wouldn't necessarily be at the back, but maybe on the side, the what corner is that, northeast corner?
Mm-hmm.
So that it's not shedding to the abutting parcel because everything was sort of going to the backyard. And that could just be, you know, if it were, or graded in a way that sort of creates a berm,
right,
to keep the water on the property and push back to the rear.
Because right now it's a 2.5 foot, you know, grade difference that it's actively shedding back to the neighbors. And so if the water collects down and where it used to just sit.
I think it's just on that one side. I don't think it's shedding to the other side.
Yeah.
This isn't shedding any significant amount of water. The issue is the neighbor's water is all coming and converging in this area.
And then
it spreads out. So, you know, putting a swale is not going to help you.
Not
it's
right
not
there. I think
situation.
On the other property line is what Mark's talking about.
Over here.
Yeah, mm-hmm. On the
there,
edge.
There isn't room, and you wouldn't get any volume out of it.
Okay.
Matter of fact, you'd create an issue. You'd be putting water up against the garage, taking out and flooding all his bushes. And eventually, the water's going to come over here anyways. So there still is a low area back here. It's not as big as it was. That's kind of where
would a French drain, which is a cheap version of your catch basin, make much difference?
No, the soils don't take the water. No.
Yeah.
Maybe I should look at this plan.
So it
meets the topo. I'm sorry. It meets the topo, the lowest low point on the north property, because your topo falls off, so it's hard for me to see that. So what you're saying is, even if it's shedding off to the side, it's actually shedding to the rear, to the side and to the rear anyway.
Right. Yeah,
because
this is already
kind
of a swale right here that's created,
right.
The way this grading's done.
Yeah.
So the water basically from here, from this corner of the building, goes back and comes back here.
The other thing, Mark, is that I think it's not clear. We probably don't even have the information in front of us to say whether it's a net positive or negative, because what we know is that the water used to shed off the roof that was there. Now, all the water coming off the roof is going into the leaching area.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a net reduction. And then to some extent, going the other way, the water's shedding from the land, from the ground. And we don't know the amount of that. It'd be impossible to measure.
Right. No, I get that.
So it seems like it's still going to end up being a net improvement to the neighborhood.
There's a lot of impervious surface along the side.
Right. There is a driveway there.
There
now.
Is, but there's probably
there's
more.
There's more, yeah, mm-hmm. Right.
But that's also
more.
Going to the street.
Right.
The front part of it is still going to the street as it did in existing conditions.
So this will also.
So
this driveway, the new driveway, will shed.
The impervious area going to the back is similar to what it was before.
Okay.
The difference being, though, is basically because this is all poor soils in back here, it wasn't draining, you could call that impervious too, and we've removed all of that.
Mm-hmm.
So
here's my thinking about the water on the lot. So I hear you that what happens to this lot should not negatively impact the neighbors, so it shouldn't make it worse.
Mm-hmm.
All of the drainage that is coming off of the new construction going into the front takes care of my concern for the roof.
Right.
So we're all, let's make it clear, we're all talking about the back of the property.
Mm-hmm.
And what has historically happened at the back of the property is the neighbor's water has all pooled at the back of this property. And so when you take away the fill dirt that is back there and you can get to real soils, I think that might be an improvement for that area. But I don't think, you know, someone made the comment that they can't be the water sink for the whole neighborhood. And I think that's it maybe some of the history of that pooling of water back there. But if they've come up with a decent way to handle the construction water, then I think we are talking about a project that is recognizing that they've got water issues and they're thinking about it. Anyone counter that? I mean, I'm just, that's my opinion. That's just where I am with it. Yeah, no, I think maybe, that's the last one though. Then I'm going to close public hearing so we just don't keep doing it.
Are you going to do site excavation at the back of the property to remove existing fill, or is your cellar foundation at the level of the existing ground there now?
The cellar foundation is going to be a little lower than the existing ground.
Right now it's sitting back of the property is at 96 feet, I think, according to the.
Yeah, and the finish elevation I think is 101, so it's going to be
seven. So that's 7 feet difference.
Yeah.
So, does anyone else in the board have a question of Mr. Reynolds? Can't read my own writing, Terry Reynolds. Anyone? Okay. Can I have a move to close public hearing?
I'm going to close the public hearing.
And Tess, second. All in favor?
Yep.
So, do we have any more debate that we want to do about this? Any
is there
other questions?
The payment in lieu for traffic, it says in the application that there's a request for a waiver. But then somebody said they
submitted a follow-up after that, and I don't know if you got that email. It's on the record that they would address their traffic impact by making a one-time payment in lieu of to the city.
That.
But there's a request for a waiver for the photometric.
Right, you didn't have a photometric plan.
Which I think would be fine.
Is one required for this?
Well, it's in any site plan, you know, so we have a list of items that are required. So since this is two units with residential, you know, lights, there aren't any site lights proposed. So that's why they asked for it.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So do we need to put that in the condition, or is that just a given? Do we have any conditions we want to put on this?
There were a couple from DPW about the tree protection.
Right.
And also the maintenance plan before construction. And then the trees were not specified as to size. So I think, I mean, I would recommend
they show a 6 foot on the plan.
It does
plan,
show
yeah.
6 foot. Okay, yeah. So that's fine. So you don't need a condition for that then.
Mm-hmm.
And then just that the payment could be made at certificate of occupancy. It doesn't have to be a building permit.
How much is the payment?
$1,000.
Anyone prepared to make that?
I'm still struggling with this one, only because it's we seem to be kind of maneuvering around the technical information that we have, that's all that we have to go by, is allowing us to get around the fact that this is a bad site, and we could be making it worse for people around this site, and I don't know how to fix that.
It's tough. I mean, my challenge, or the way that I'm trying to, I guess, figure out, you know, rationalize it, is that there are systemic stormwater issues, and I don't know that we can have a positive impact on these systemic neighborhood-wide stormwater and city-wide stormwater issues just on this parcel. I mean, there needs to be stormwater mitigation on every single parcel in this area. Mm-hmm. Now, we can't, none of the other neighbors are coming here with permit applications. There's nothing that we can do to compel that or incentivize that, because there's no grant funding for that, or, you know, but that's my challenge is, like, you know, this is a systemic issue that needs to be addressed, and it needs to be addressed at a much bigger municipal level. Mm-hmm. And on a case by case, you know, they are, you know, far and away above and beyond mitigating stormwater and managing it better than any other abutting parcel. But it is kind of bothering me that, yes, there has been this historical issue, but is there, you know, without coordination between the adjacent parcels, it's, right, you know, how much can we
mandate? Well, wasn't the coordination mandate before just the natural, naturally, the fact that this piece of property?
Well, anytime water is collecting, it's a problem.
Well, I get that, but, I mean, the natural fix, if you could call it that, was the water flowing through this yard.
Right. It was a wet basement this year.
Well, yeah.
And so what was there before, so we're getting rid of the natural fix. We were allowing for the getting rid of the natural fix for something that potentially is better. I mean, it seems like, you know, again, the house, it's definitely better, but the land is, seems like it could be worse. And
I think you have to be, I think if you, in order to deny a permit, there has to be a reason why technically you don't think it's meeting the standards. So you've been shown that the property is taking care of more of the impervious area and the runoff than existing conditions, and allowing it to infiltrate in on-site as opposed to existing conditions. And the water will continue to flow as it has in existing conditions to the back from this site. And it's not blocking water from the abutting parcels to continue to flow. So even though it's maybe hard to quantify how much pushing back the grade will change that, what you've been shown is that there's more water being taken care of to the front than existing conditions. And then also, as was mentioned by John, and I mentioned it, that this is a very small project in this site, and that someone else could come forward with almost an identical project and not even come before the board, yep, and there would be no mitigation at all.
Right. Yep. I agree with that. I mean, technically,
yeah,
if this was a technical discussion, it would be a 10-minute discussion, but it's an hour-long discussion because we're not talking about the technical stuff. We're talking about, we're assuming technically it's going to perform the way it's been demonstrated, but that doesn't, it's just a, I think you said it clearest, is that this one site is doing all that it can on this one site, but it might make the other sites around it worse. But that doesn't mean, in all these past years, maybe the abutters have been the beneficiaries of this one bad site, and now this one site is finally fixing itself, yeah, and now they're going to get right.
I'm afraid I feel a little bit like that.
Yeah.
And that's the, you know, they're improving the runoff that's not going to the back by taking everything they can to a drainage system that is unusual for us to see for a private residence.
Right.
I think just add to you, it's not just a technical, but it's right to build site issue too. Because they are complying with the requirements. In principle, they should be able to do it, right? To build on that.
Right.
So it's technical, it's a right to build. And I think that if the neighbors also do some mitigation for flour, or to avoid it, because everything was going in his backyard. I mean, so as somebody says that, you say that they taking advantage of that plot. So, but that plot belongs to somebody, and somebody is building something in that.
what they'll be doing, how they can cooperate with that. You'll be just on top of the new developer. So you have to think about the fairness of this.
Yeah.
And I agree with that. That's how I think it should go.
Okay. Speaks to the city needing stormwater management.
Can we make it a condition that they give a sump pump to all their abutters?
But I did not realize the back of the lot was fill. That to me is at the heart of the problem.
Right, but yeah. In theory, so if they replace that with good draining soils, and then inside of that they built the house, that's one thing. They're only going to replace where the house is going to go. And so outside of the footprint of the house, it's still going to be fill. Yep. So it's still not going to drain.
But I think that's part of what is happening to the neighbors, too. That is the same, you know, clay, fill, brick, crushed up, everything that's probably there, too.
Yep.
Can I get a motion? First, I don't want to rush you. Does anyone else have any thoughts they want? I mean, I sense we're all kind of uncomfortable about it, but I think that, you know, from my point of view, I don't find a skyhook to hang the property up for. I mean,
I agree.
They could come back to us they could go do a house without having to come back to us, and we wouldn't even have the benefit of the drainage or this discussion. Mm-hmm. So.
I move approval of site plan for the new family residence at 1 North Main Street, Florence, MAP ID 176-240 with
DPW requirements,
yeah.
Tree protection, payment in lieu of.
And the maintenance for this.
And the maintenance contract.
Mm-hmm.
Do I get a second?
Second.
Second by Dan. All in favor? Okay. Thank you. I hope the neighborhood pulls together and could figure out something. I'm so sorry.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah.
It's like, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Motion to close by the second. Second from John. All in favor?
Yep.
Aye.